everyone. Happy to have you here for another episode of Legacy Matters. Our show is growing, and the lives and legacies of the people around us have taken on a new importance as we take stock of what is most precious to us. As always, our show will focus on building and preserving your legacy, the importance of community, and the telling of stories we find amusing. Thanks for joining us. Now, enjoy the show. So mad at me because I didn't record the pre-podcast.
The preamble, the pre-pod.
You guys missed the best part.
I mean, it's done.
You know what's so funny is we say that a lot, but it's true.
Okay, I'll start recording it.
It's always like we all of a sudden we're like, oh, damn it, we didn't record
anything.
We
can put it in as bonus at the end. It's not a great way to start a show because here we are.
Oh, this is.
Welcome.
No, this is welcoming how much you missed.
The best way to start a show.
Yeah, you missed so much when you weren't able to listen to it.
Yeah, if you like our show, what you'd really like is the part that we don't share with you.
Oh, God, that's fun.
They're the best part.
That's so much fun.
The better show happens before you. You don't even get to listen to it. It's fine. It's just us.
That's how good it is.
What do we need to do? We need to thank the Comedy Corner Underground for letting us use this space.
They have not thrown us out yet.
We have an announcement. We're doing live shows. We're going to do one in
March.
March, thank you.
Yep.
March. I was going to say February.
First one, March.
I don't do months.
Because you're great with dates.
Memories.
Names are even better. It's going to be fun.
Yeah. Thanks. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Legacy Manager Podcast, blah, 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 blah. What else?
So welcoming.
I know. It was like, it was, I mean, it draws them right in, right?
Like, oh my God, I'm so excited now. I feel
I
the energy.
I love it. It's so great. What do we need to say?
We have someone here.
Yeah, we just want to get to the
That's
meat
it.
And potatoes.
Is that it? Okay,
yeah.
We'll just go. We have a guest.
Yes, we do.
And our guest's name is Kim. I know that much.
That's good. You got that.
I got the
first part. You got that right.
The first part, right? Yeah.
You want to try the last name?
Do it.
Can you just tell me the letters?
I want to see you,
try
just because it's going to be awkward.
Can you give me the letters?
Do you have the letters?
I don't have the letters.
You don't. You just knew that some girl named Kim is coming in?
Kim's supposed to show up.
Your email address is like one Kim. It doesn't say your name. Like your name, it's not. If your email address was Kim such and such, then I would maybe
still
take
not
a stab
know
at it.
Still not. I was going to say, I'm like, what email address did I send from?
Yeah.
Oh, I know.
I mean,
W.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
I.
Yeah.
T.
Yeah.
C.
Oh.
Z.
Oh.
A K.
Yeah. No.
Witczak.
Oh.
Yeah. That would have been my guess.
You got it right.
Is that it?
Yeah, I'm very impressed.
Oh, thank you.
Everybody always, when they're like, Witczak, and I go at a restaurant, they're like, what's your last name? I'm Witczak. And they're like, what's that? Your last name. They think I say, what's that?
What's that?
I'm like, oh, my God.
Oh, my God. That's kind of funny.
I'm not doing this.
It took me.
Can I have my table, please?
Yeah, exactly. That is my last name.
Nice. My family would give aliases at the point of taking restaurant reservations, and we would always use the name Buttafuoco.
Buttafuoco.
Yeah.
Oh, Joey
Buttafuoco. Just to see like what would happen in the restaurant. Like, but Buttafuoco, a party of six.
Looking for some recognition.
And then a bunch of Irish people walk up.
Right, exactly.
It's fun.
Wasn't there like a guy, Joey Buttafuoco?
Yeah, baby.
That's what I don't even remember what that's from.
Yeah, what happened to Joey Buttafuoco?
I don't know.
He's living in Maine.
Who was he?
I don't know.
I'm thinking of the guy who got his penis cut off.
No. That's John Wayne
Bobbitt. And I actually.
Who knows Bobbitt?
You don't tell us you've met him.
Exactly.
No, I have.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, no
really.
Shit.
When I worked at Jenny Jones' talk show in Chicago.
Really?
Yeah. He was one of our guests.
Because after he got it sewn back on, he went into porn.
Yeah, and we had him on as our guest. And literally, we had to keep him twice, or like for two shows in a row.
Because he was so funny?
Well, he was funny, but he brought his brothers, and then I brought my brother-in-law, I should say, he's a Chicago cop, and he goes, I want to go to this show. And I'm like, no, you can't. He goes, I want to ride up in the elevator, because I had to bring him up and down.
Yeah.
And so
we do that here, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no elevator here. Don't get in trouble.
My God. Well, my brother-in-law goes, can I please ride up in the elevator? And I said, all right, literally, Chris, don't you dare say anything. So he was sitting in the corner, and all of a sudden he starts singing, I'm not half the man I used to be. And I was like,
you.
Mercy.
He's like, I didn't say anything.
Yep, exactly. That's what he said. He goes, I was like, oh my God, you. I go, I could get fired from this job.
Yeah, he didn't
care. I actually did
You did. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and that's different than Joey Buttafuoco.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
but does anyone remember what?
Yeah, Amy Fisher and Joey Buttafuoco. So they were having an affair,
I remember a lot of
the
teal.
Long Island scandal.
Okay.
And
Amy Fisher.
And then
shot.
She, yeah, tried to attempted murder Mrs. Buttafuoco. Didn't work.
Oh. Yeah, that's right. And but yeah. the wife like took him back, right?
Yeah.
For a while anyway.
Yeah.
Or something.
Yeah.
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 Why not?
No way.
Yeah.
No.
Hard no.
No.
Hard
no.
And fast. Yep. Real nope. No.
But they happened around the same time. That's why they're yes. mixed up in my head
right.
together.
Yeah. It was yeah. a weird time.
Yeah. It was in the 90s.
The fucking yeah. 90s.
I mean, right? Yeah. I was going to say yeah. it was the 90s. Yeah.
It gave me the impression early. That affairs are bad.
It took that.
Well, you know what?
shot in the face, or you might get your penis.
Glad that was your yeah, defining say, point.
Yep. Yeah, that's actually a good. If that's your
yeah.
lesson,
wow. Okay.
Yeah, that's
wow.
what I learned out of it.
That's what you took out of it. Oh, I don't want my penis cut off. I'm gonna be a good boy.
Intact.
Wow. And you've kept it away ever since.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, those are the things you learn when you're young and
yeah,
impressionable.
I love that. Actually.
Yeah. Yeah. That's yeah, I'm an experiential.
Don't if you're like a 30-year-old married man, don't date a high schooler.
Yeah,
that's another lesson.
See,
you yeah. could that one.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah,
never had that problem.
Oh, no. Right. No, no, and nope. I'm past 30, so yeah. if I did it now,
yeah, it'd be
just a little, just a touch, tish.
There are so many creepy songs from the 70s about dating,
yeah,
17-year-olds or whatever.
Yep.
Like,
yep.
It was a different time.
Yeah. It was a different time,
right. Still yeah. never
I mean,
appropriate.
You
it was
don't
just
even,
a different time.
You don't even have yeah. to go back that far
yeah.
to no? the 70s to find creepy songs about dating women 15. Who are too young for the person singing the song.
Yeah. Yeah, well, but yeah. Those are mostly tongue-in-cheek these days, right?
Or when they wrote it, maybe they were the appropriate age, and when they finally got famous at 30, it's like, yeah. yeah, dude, you should not be singing that anymore.
There's some rap songs that are a little
okay.
bit like, oh, okay.
Talking about what? The high school girl when you're in high school is maybe okay, but yeah. yeah.
No. What happened to 40? Our show?
Yeah.
Whatever happens.
It took a hard left immediately.
Oh, you brought up John Bobbitt.
It used to be yeah. a show where we would get to know somebody.
I think we like, are.
I mean, we,
I've learned a lot.
You might be.
Yeah, I think we've learned a lot
we
already.
We could probably table that
yeah.
previous conversation yeah. and get back on track.
See? We could do that. It's not even the second half. It
no.
feels like a second
just
half.
Wait.
If
just
you
wait.
See what happens is the second oh half God. Is usually crazy.
Yeah, because then we've gotten to know everybody
we've
and now we're in.
We've exhausted this whole like, okay, so Kim, what brings you in?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, like that's usually.
Right, which is a good question. How did this happen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How did this happen?
How did this happen? We're very happy to have you
here. We're waiting
on
you. This yeah. is if there's any dead air here, it's because yeah. Kim's not answering.
We never know. We never know who and how people are.
Our direct question.
Yeah, I was like, how did I get here?
Senator, what brings you in today?
Exactly.
I drove here.
Right, right. That's one way.
So that's one way I got here.
Yeah.
Wait, I was trying to think. Lori.
I know how you got
oh,
here.
Oh, you somebody I introduced.
Do.
I was like, wait a minute. Like, I have to like, explain all of it.
Someone basically
he
strong
asked because
me
we don't know.
I
and
know.
Said and, yeah. and was like, you have to have this person on your show. And I was like, I don't think so. And they were like, yes, or we'll. I don't know. They were gonna. Maybe give us, give
I'm
us our
stuck
first
on
and only
you being strong-armed.
Wow, we can't have that. If someone's going to get around to it,
you're not the strong-arm type. You're yeah. just you're the no. fold
you
type.
Yes.
Like, yeah, you want to be on the
sure.
show? Great,
sure. Okay, you want to come on? All right, great.
Great, sounds good.
Yes, actually,
we'll
so
next Tuesday.
because you are somehow affiliated with Susanna Newell. That's yes. There's some connection there, and someone. Who likes Susanna and knows you at the same time said, you know, you did a really good job with this one. You should have this person in. And that's Ooh. You, Kim.
Oh, cool. There you go. Wow.
That's how it all came about.
All right.
Good.
So it was a
Who's
recommendation.
Susanna?
Did you talk to Susanna?
I did not.
I didn't. That's why I'm like, who's Susanna?
You what, must.
Wait
that must,
a
that's...
minute.
Yeah.
You did. You missed that show, Kate.
Which one
oh,
was it?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
That's how little I do.
Wow.
I don't research before or after.
He doesn't.
and move on.
Guilty as charged.
There's two R words. There's research and retain, and he does neither of them.
Okay.
Who's this?
So Susanna was the woman who was injured by the vaccine.
Oh, yeah, of course I remember.
Ooh. Yes.
Yeah, I needed to miss that one. Yeah.
I know.
That
you would have really loved her. She's a lovely person.
Yeah, she's amazing.
She was really cool.
People who have listened to that show, so it was, I don't know if you know this, but that was a controversial topic. Because it sounds anti-vax.
Yeah. But it's not.
No, she was
not.
It wasn't controversial. She was great. I'll say it again. You go back and listen to that show. If we inject the majority of the population with anything, someone's going to get hurt from it. And that was her point.
Yeah.
Yep.
And I think that's a very fair point.
Yeah.
I think that's that is a totally fair point.
And I just want to be heard. And and by the way, we could, the people who've been injured, the small percentage of people, not telling you not to take the vaccine.
Yes. Yep.
But the people who got injured could use a little help.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
For sure.
And because they took one for the team. Yep. And I completely agreed with that message.
Yeah, it was great.
But then I was worried she was going to be crazy.
I can't believe you didn't remember that.
I think I was worried Kim might be crazy too.
Yeah.
She can hear you.
We're only 10 minutes in.
Yeah, exactly.
You have no idea.
We got plenty of time to figure it out.
You already heard about the John Wayne Bobbitt story.
Right.
There you go.
First name basis.
No, I was pretty sure you weren't going to be crazy. Because Susanna wasn't. We haven't had anyone on who I wouldn't. If something went totally awry and the show just didn't work,
you'd never hear
about
it.
I just wouldn't hear it.
Yeah, you wouldn't hear it. That's like,
I don't know.
Exactly.
Yeah. I don't know that person.
I don't know what happened to that show. Oh, it got lost.
Real sorry.
I'm a producer. I know how those things work.
Can't prove it.
Whoops.
So what brings you in today?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, that's a nice segue. Oh, my gosh. Well, it's so I do know Susanna. I met her.
Yeah.
Actually, I met her because I also have a story that's kind of like hers, the small percent.
Okay.
And so I say that because it started, it was 20 years ago, and I was living life. I mean, I'm in advertising. I'm a producer here in town.
20 years ago. I just need to do this. We're talking 2003-ish.
Yep, 2003. Exactly. Okay. 2003.
I'm trying to put myself back into this time.
When this gets beamed out, you're a producer? The audience, people won't know.
Mm-hmm.
Of what?
Advertising. I worked at Fallon.
Do you do free shit for podcasts that need
stuff?
leading the witness.
I was like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
But I am freelance now, I've been freelance.
Right.
But, okay, so 2003, living life. I was married and traveling the world on productions. I did all the BMW stuff. And I was married to my husband of almost 10 years. And he had just started his dream job with a startup company and started having trouble sleeping. So he went to his doctor, and his doctor gives him a sample pack of Zoloft, which is an antidepressant, and said, hey, take this. It'll help take the edge off. I happened to be out of the country the first 3 weeks he got put on it. It was a sample pack. I was down in New Zealand having the time of my life.
Yeah.
And he was given an antidepressant who had no idea what it really even was.
Right.
But he was like a Humpty Dumpty kind of guy, meaning he was a big athlete. He always went to the doctor.
Well, you're going to have to...
Self-care. Self-care.
Yeah. Yeah, you've told this story before. I can tell because you're telling it really fast. What's a Humpty Dumpty guy? I don't know what that means.
All right. So I was going to say I have told this story for a long time.
Yeah.
But Humpty Dumpty is kind of, like when you're an athlete, you go and he had somebody bite into his head from basketball. So you had to get stitches.
Right.
You break your arm. You got to get a cast on.
Right.
He falls apart, gets put back together. Yeah, you get back. Exactly.
Didn't Humpty not get put back together?
Well,
didn't they put like all the king's horses and all the king's men on the task and they did not get put together?
That's what I always say. And if it's now, you're like, oh, wait, maybe Humpty Dumpty is not the right
thing.
Oh my God, you
be that guy.
But all right. So maybe I don't know.
So maybe this is more appropriate than you initially thought.
Yes, maybe.
I'm fixing it.
So now,
well, thank you.
You're spot on with what you said because I feel like we're getting there.
Oh, you know what? Great. Mm-hmm. That is a great. See, I knew what I was talking about.
You see, you're
Humpty
so right.
Dumpty.
Yeah, Sam's so right. Wrong. You're right.
You're right.
You're good. Well, you are
you're
the
right.
guest.
We'll right. give it to you. So then you'll just say I'm right.
Yeah. Right.
So he went to the doctor. You know, he went to the doctor. Yeah. I'm having a great time. I come home, and I was excited to see him. And I'll never forget. Wood walked through the back door. I had no idea what was going on because I was gone.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So I remember coming in the back door. And Wood came in and he was like completely drenched in his blue dress shirt, fell to the floor. He was in sales. He like a big, full of life guy. He fell to the floor and he's like, Kim, you got to help. And he was like in his head, hands around his head, like a vice.
Really?
And he's like, you got to help me, Kim. You got to help me. I don't know what's happening. My head's outside my body. And he's rocking back and forth, bawling. And I was like, I've never seen this like, in our like hell? 10 right. years of marriage. Yeah. God,
terrifying.
And so I said, you know, we calmed him down, like did yoga breathing, prayed, like called the doctor, and the doctor's like, you got to give it 4 to 6 weeks to kick in the drug. So every night the next week, Wood's like, hey, what do you think about acupuncture? I'm going to beat this feeling in my head. What do you think about hypnosis? I'm going to beat this feeling in my head of feeling outside his body.
No, the doctor says, get the fuck off that.
Yeah, well, no. No.
Oh,
and
Jesus.
He instead said 4 to 6 weeks. And so I happened to, it was my busy time of the, you know, my season. And so I was out of town again. We both traveled. So like traveling was no big deal for us. So on August 6th, I hadn't heard from Wood all day. So I called my dad. I'm like, hey, Dad, do me a favor. Because they live like, you know, just a couple miles down. I'm like, would you do me a favor? Woody started this new job. And like, he's been having trouble sleeping. So I'm afraid that maybe he hit his head.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm thinking. And my dad goes over and he's like, sure. It's like 9 o'clock. I'm still shooting in the studio in Detroit. And all of a sudden he called me and he's like, it's bad. It's bad. And I'm like, what do you mean it's bad? He's like, he's dead. And I'm like, what?
What?
I'm like, what do you mean he's dead? And he's like, he's hanging. I'm like, what? And so he was found hanging by the rafters in our garage.
Jeez.
No history of depression.
No history, nothing.
Nope.
Kim,
do you remember?
I'm so sorry.
No history of depression. And I know, like, that's the thing. I know it's like, you didn't know what you guys were walking
through. No, we did not. Good. Do you remember when we started the show and it was fun? And
I was bracing for impact as a fellow widow. High five.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So... Yeah, you get it.
It's the worst thing ever.
It's the worst thing ever. And so I mean, there was nothing to prepare me for that call.
No,
that, like,
how could there be?
Me. No. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, what? Like, that doesn't even make sense. What? Like, and I'm like running around
register.
Like, it doesn't even register. Yeah. And I remember like sitting out in the parking lot going, what? And I remember like trying to calm myself down and walk back into the studio. And I didn't want anybody. Like, we're all shooting. We're all young.
Yeah,
like,
right. Like, you don't want to disrupt the whole thing.
I don't want to disrupt the whole thing. But yet, in myself, I'm like, what the fuck just happened? Excuse me.
Right. No, you can swear.
What just happened? So I, like, walked over to a friend. I'm like, that I was working with. I'm like, can you do me a favor? There's been an emergency. I kind of need to get back to the hotel. And then, so then when I got back in the car, he's like, what happened? And I'm like, I don't even know what, I don't even know how to say it, but Woody killed himself. And, and they're like, what? And he was this guy that, like, loved life. So it made absolutely no sense, right?
Yeah, right.
So I know I have to always let, because I've been doing this work now for 20 years.
Yeah.
I call myself an accidental advocate.
Yeah.
Right.
And so I, that night, you know, I'm sitting at the hotel. My whole family just fell apart. Like, you know, my mom and dad.
A bomb goes off in your life. Yeah.
Like, and it's not even, like, the same, you know, like, you're all of a sudden now ripped off of this path and you're over here and you have no idea who you are anymore and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And
that resonates.
I mean, cause you know, it's a crazy thing. And so that night, then the coroner came over and, you know, my neighbors are out. I lived in Southwest Minneapolis and, the coroner called and asked a question. Was he on any medication?
As a matter of fact,
I go, well, yeah, but I didn't even think anything of it, right?
Right.
I go, I think it's upstairs in the medicine cabinet. She goes, oh, well, there's a bottle sitting on the counter, weirdly, under a light. and said, a bottle of Zoloft. I'm like, oh, yeah, yeah, that's it. I didn't even know anything about it.
Yeah, you're the guy.
Yeah, right.
Like, it was new in your life at that point.
Right,
yeah.
Like, completely new.
Right.
And also, like, I never questioned anything, right?
Sure.
And so she goes, we're going to take it with us. It might have something to do with his death. So that was kind of clue number one.
Right.
The other clue was the front page of the Minneapolis paper had an article that said the UK finds link between antidepressants and suicide in teens.
Okay.
And that, same day.
Yeah.
The same day.
Same day.
Yeah.
And Woody always left notes. Like when he traveled, he would always, like we always left, I mean, they're usually honeydew lists.
Right,
like,
exactly.
But it's, it counts.
Know, but
a note like, by the way, welcome home, get this shit done.
Yeah.
Yeah, do this.
Totally.
Yeah.
Can you go to the, you know, whatever.
I need you to buy stuff.
But he would always leave notes. We always left notes. But I'm like, the biggest trip of your life, and you left no note.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, no note.
Right.
Nothing.
Right.
And so, but those.
That's the days before smartphones.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
No, well.
But you would even think.
Pretty
like,
close.
Pretty close, yeah.
I mean, yeah, they were like the flip phones or Blackberries.
So you're still,
Razor days.
Razor days.
Yeah.
Look, we're aging ourselves here.
No, we're aging everyone if they know what we're talking about. So it's okay.
Well, I just, you know, I like fine. Context.
But, yeah, it does. It like puts it into like the era it was. But
yeah, I mean, it was a long time.
Right, because why aren't they just video chatting? Well, because it wasn't like that.
Yeah, you didn't. But we talked all the time, even when we were like traveling and stuff like that. So, but to not leave, he didn't leave any note.
Yeah. Right.
And we had like a really solid relationship. Yeah. All of
did
this.
Did he have a history of depression or anything?
No.
Yeah.
Nothing.
See.
None.
So didn't leave a note because this was all just completely and utterly brand new.
It was completely. Thing. And you know, that head outside the body.
Right.
And so that night, my brother-in-law, my sister, but by this time, my sister calls like my brother-in-law and the whole family comes over and he goes home and he was like, what? This doesn't even make sense. Like would love life. He was like you know, if you walked into a room, you felt him. He was like super full of energy.
I gotta do the same thing I did with Susanna.
Yeah.
I think people who go through things, whatever, and they're trying to explain something, like Susanna did this with her own health.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You're justifying like his life and him not killing himself as if like, okay, it would have been different had he like not loved life or,
right.
You know what I mean?
It's like another layer of trauma.
Yeah.
But the only reason I point that out is because it's just clear that this was way out of character. Something was completely and utterly different about this particular moment in time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it started when the medications started.
Yeah. You know what? Thank you for saying that because I mean, I think, but it is like a pretty traumatic, it was like, what? Like, it didn't make any sense, right?
Right.
Like,
it still doesn't.
It shouldn't. And it still doesn't really even though I've done a lot of things since then and we'll talk about it, but you know, when never once did we question the drug, like first of all, I didn't even know what it really was because you know what, you're adult, I'm an adult, like
a doctor prescribed it
and it's advertised and sold as safe and effective, which I've now come to like, I don't believe those are just marketing words.
Right.
And then it was FDA approved. Right. So then you, like, all of that. But my brother-in-law goes home because it made no sense to him either and just Googles Zoloft and suicide. And little did we know that in 1991, the FDA had hearings when it was just, in 1991, when it was just the Prozac on the market, and it was the emergence of violence and suicide.
Yeah.
And at that point, the FDA did nothing. They told, and all the advisory committee members who sat on that committee had financial ties with the companies that made the antidepressants.
Yeah. Yeah.
They all voted, nope, we don't see any link. And yet, meanwhile, there are all these families coming forward and people.
But my bank account looks great.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. I don't care about your family because I'm going to be rich and I'm dirty.
And it's so true.
It's like, a small percentage. It's like, no, that's not how it works.
You're destroying lives.
Yeah.
It's so funny when you just said, I mean, that's a whole other thing. But like when we found out this and the FDA told Eli Lilly to study suicidality. Because, you know, they didn't see any issues, the committee members. They never did. The FDA never followed up. Meanwhile, it's 12 years later, and now we've got Zoloft on the market and Paxil, and right. we've approved it for kids.
Yeah.
And it so that became like my mission is to go out to DC and, you know, I mean, first of all, I was like anybody who could listen and,
right.
you know, yeah. and get yep. out and met with all of our Congress, but mm-hmm. Got FDA or eventually I always call it the battle for Woody. We went out to Washington, D.C. to really push the FDA and Congress to investigate why is Europe doing something that we're not.
Right.
Then, you know, bring in all this information. So my battle included going to meet with FDA, HHS, Congress, and then I had a big failure to warn wrongful death lawsuit against Pfizer. Mm-hmm. And I also like Woody's story because he went from not sleeping from a new job.
Right.
Right.
To head outside the body.
A little right. stress.
Right.
To yeah. dead.
To right. 5 weeks later hanging.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
Hanging.
Yeah.
Like, and so it became, and so eventually we did get black box suicide warnings, which mm-hmm. is the most, you know,
yeah.
everybody, any drug yep. you take, you should always look at the insert and yep. see if there's a box at the top. Yeah, I know I'm not always good at when the
no, because
paperwork.
You trust the doctors. Yeah. Yeah. You trust, but, I mean, I don't take anything. And yeah. my older
I think people
a
are learning that they yeah. should trust themselves when it comes to it.
That's
I think
it.
You have
worry
to.
About your when it comes to medical care.
But
sure, but.
But imagine all the people yeah. who just kind of don't have the wherewithal to
right.
do that.
Right.
To,
I
mean, like, look into it.
I mean,
it.
Yeah. honestly, I was one of those. Like, I yeah. mean, we trust. I never even questioned
so
it.
So around yeah. this same time, I've got my own stories with this. Around the same time, I lost a cousin, a longtime friend of mine, and then my wife's cousin. So two cousins. But anyway, all to suicide, all related to them being on antidepressants. I believed this all happened right around the early 2000s.
Yeah.
And I was working at a camp at the time, and I saw the difference in the kids when they started sending all these kids to camp on these things too. And just like the different problems we were having with them. And then three people close to me all within a year killed themselves.
Wow.
And all of them, every one of them, it was just known that they had either recently started taking or taken themselves off of
yeah.
antidepressants.
And those are the most dangerous times yeah. is when you first go on
yeah. Yeah.
Dosage changes or coming off. And if you think about it, Wood had, he got a sample pack, you know, back yeah. when they were given,
right.
here
you
some,
go, everybody.
Here you go.
Try some
yeah.
Zoloft, you're not sleeping.
Yeah,
this'll fix it.
This will mm-hmm. fix it. Like, what? I mean, he didn't even.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah, yeah. And he never even, like, because I think, you know, Humpty Dumpty, he trusted.
Yeah,
right.
She didn't fix so many
times. Another yes. doctor yes. visit.
Humpty Dumpty.
Okay. Something yeah. to I'm fix. Telling you, Humpty Dumpty was in a yeah. pile of yeah. it was yolk and whatever else, right?
Yolk and shell, Bubba.
Yolk and shell, and that's it. Just kidding.
Oh my God. No, but it's true. And so yeah. you never question, but
right.
I didn't know anything about these drugs, but you know, funny. So, you know, I call myself the accidental drug mm-hmm. safety advocate.
Right.
And I'll just like tell you how I met Susanna. I met her actually in Washington, D.C. at one of the Senator Johnson had a hearing where it was all the victims of the, and some experts, and
oh,
I
from
was,
the COVID vaccine.
Yeah, yeah. And so I was, that was the first time I met her or really had knew any of those people
right.
out there. But I've been for a long time. I started a nonprofit, Woody Matters, and I now sit on an FDA advisory panel.
Mm-hmm.
I do a lot of work. I've testified in the U.S. Senate, all about the small, like representing
right.
the voice of those
right.
oh.
every day.
And
you
look
know.
At us and accidentally.
Right.
Yeah.
And
right.
accidentally, haphazardly, and almost with some humor advocating right. for those people, too.
Yes.
Like, yeah.
we're not
yeah.
what you can do.
Yeah.
You know, the thing is, yeah. you just have to listen to people is
right.
the deal.
Right.
Like, we all have to listen to each other.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't, you know, those drugs are, I mean, whether it's the vaccine or antidepressants, they're probably bringing some benefit to a lot of people too,
yes.
right?
Yeah.
Yep.
But there's going to be
not
some
everyone.
People who it just totally it ruins their lives.
Right.
It's not like, one size fits
it's
all.
No.
Exactly. It's
it needs
not
to be
one.
Customized to that person.
Well, because you know what? All of well, I used to always call Woody, what we call, or his brothers always called him Two Brew Tim. He could have one beer, the second one he was on the floor. Now, right. I could drink a whole bottle of wine and be totally fine.
Yeah, I think.
You. Yeah.
Other people might say that.
They tell me I'm fine.
She's running down the street naked, but she likes that.
But yeah,
she's
that's fine. What she always fine. Does. Fine. Yeah, it was less than a bottle of wine. Yeah, what?
It would be a full bottle. So, I mean, that's it. Like, one size fits all, never, you know, those are some of those messages. And I never thought I'd be doing this. But, you know, when you were just talking about, like, kids at camp.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I helped start years before. There's an organization in Minnesota that was called Free Arts. And it was working with kids that had been abused, neglected, at risk, using the power of arts and volunteers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so I loved working with those kids. And I worked with a group of them at St. Joe's, it's a group home type thing, and they were 8 to 12. We just had a great session with them, and the staff was like, hey, kids, do you want to show your do you want to show the volunteers where you live? And, you know, they all walk into, like, a locked dorm room, like what we went to college with, right? But they, every one of those kids picked up a cup of meds, and I'm like,
like, what the?
Well, and I'm thinking, they have strep throat, and I hate taking pills.
No, it's mind-altering bullshit.
Yes. Yeah. And that's what they said. Like, she goes, it's just their behavior medicine. I'm like, behavior medicine?
And
like, you can medicate away behavior?
Or trauma.
Thank you.
Or trauma.
Yeah.
You can't.
No.
And I'm like, you know, I'm not an anti-vax person.
But you can't.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of things, like, I do believe in Western and Eastern medicines. Yeah. I do believe that there's a lot of things. But, like, something in that, where are the adults saying, whoa, this is kind of bullshit? Like, like, you can't tell me that you can take a group of kids with trauma in a place and give them some pill, and then that's going to fix it. Like, put them out in nature or something.
Yeah.
You know, do
that
something.
That stands a better chance of working than just medicating it away.
Some different combination would be a good
idea. Hugs.
Love.
Now I'm going to cry.
Yeah. Like, stop it. Some therapy. Very targeted.
Art, music. Yes. Like, how about just hanging out with cool people? Like,
how about
little
just
kids?
Talking to them? Yeah, nice
therapy.
To them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Have them come here and just, like, watch you guys. They would think this is the coolest thing ever.
Oh.
They would.
I want to do a show with kids. I've thought about this. I really do. God. I used to play a game at camp.
But he's tearing up.
I am tearing up.
Sam is the heart of the Ghostbusters here.
I had to point it out.
I played a game at camp all the time. So I worked for 20 years at a boys' camp, and I loved it. Loved it. But in the evenings, we'd have free time, and free time meant you could go sailing, you could play tennis, you could. I liked to sit. There's a game called Washers. And you just throw these little washers into cups in the ground. There's a little court and stuff. And it's really cute. It's like, I don't know. It's like horseshoes, but miniature or something.
Yeah.
Right. Yep. And, but there'd always be 10 or 15 kids sitting there playing washers. And then, but they'd come and sit because they wanted to talk to an adult. So I would go sit on the bench and hang out with them. And I'd play this game, Ask Me Anything. And they could ask absolutely any question that came to mind. None of them ever asked, like, the really, really difficult ones that I was expecting.
Yeah, the context.
You know, like, they just didn't go there for
like,
some reason.
I don't want to know.
But they'd ask, and you can always answer a kid's question appropriately, even if it's a difficult question or it deals with a difficult subject. Anyway, so I want to do a show like that.
Honestly, like, how great would that be? But I think that is true when I look at all the kids that are being medicated now, or trauma.
I feel like it's gotten a little better. I hope. No, it's not gotten better.
I don't know. I think the opposite.
Still medicating,
I feel like,
the shit out of kids.
Everybody. Like,
really?
I feel like,
God, maybe it's just because I'm not around.
21 billion. I just actually, I was just tweeting about this. $21 billion global antidepressant market estimated by 2030. The kids, ever since the whole, like, pandemic and locked up even adults, it was hard on everybody. And so, like, they're estimating that it's actually gotten worse, believe it or not.
Oh, God, I hate to hear that.
And it bums me out because I worked so hard to get those black box warnings put on these, and suicides are rising, the drug prescription rates are rising. I'm like, So it's pretty frustrating. So, but I love like having like normal like everyday conversations with everyday people is kind of
our show. Our show sucks. Yeah. No, it's so terrible. We have these people on and they talk.
They talk. I mean, make sense. And talk great stuff. Get to learn about people and their stuff.
No, and so you know what? Here's what you guys. I can already tell what you add. Yeah. Laughter.
Yeah, you have to.
You have to.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Seriously,
laughter.
Yeah. I mean, we've had brain trauma. We've had death. Yeah. We've had brain trauma again. We've had all this and. It's always a little bit hard to get the first, like, to be the person who throws the first joke in after someone tells the story of their beloved husband dying.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you're like, okay.
Jesus Christ.
And
yeah, well, I guess I'll be the a-hole this time.
Yeah.
Throw one out there.
But it is. But, I mean, there's always going to be trauma. There's always going to be, unfortunately.
I mean, life is just so stinking hard.
Life sucks sometimes. Yeah. But you can't
be
like,
you got to talk about it.
I'm done. It's like, no, you keep going on. You find the things that keep you going.
You got to talk about people who got hurt by vaccines. You got to talk about people who died because they took Zoloft. I mean, like, you got to figure out.
Have these conversations.
As a society, we got to do this.
But, you know, like, when you just said you lost your husband and, you know, you talked about suffering. Like, the reality is this is life.
Yeah.
And it, I mean, the idea that we think we can actually go through without it's stupid.
No.
Like,
and the suffering, it helps. It helps give you perspective.
Yes.
You know, I hate it.
Yes.
Yep.
We all hate it. But, we don't deal with it.
It's never
very
a good thing, but there can be good that comes out of it.
It
can be
you
something
grow.
You can do with it.
It is how you grow.
Yeah.
It is how, unfortunately, it is how, I mean, the only way, like, if you think about it, a butterfly doesn't become, like, a beautiful butterfly. Mm-hmm. It has to be in the dark.
It's got to be in that goo.
And that goo.
Gotta
and
be in
the
that goo for it.
It's a process.
And if heaven forbid that poor butterfly is sitting there on a branch, right?
Yeah.
And it gets windy and it falls and it breaks like Humpty Dumpty. You can't put
that back together.
God, I knew I'd get her.
Just
with
trying
that
to bring
one.
It back around.
Oh my God, stop.
All right, all right.
I'm gonna laugh. But I actually had some funny when you said. So I had like these three widow friends, and everybody always thinks I say widow. Like my widow friends.
That might be
they're
the
all
wine.
Under five
that's
feet
the wine
tall.
Talking at
no,
that point.
My widow friends. But, you know, I met these ladies, like friends of mine after Wood died. And we would go and we always said, hey, we like deserve. And people are like, expected. I don't know if they thought we wouldn't laugh again. Like, I didn't know if I would ever laugh again at the time.
Understandably so.
But then I was but I'm like, we deserve to like laugh at stupid stuff and we can say it and this is how you get through it.
Yeah. Almost more so absolutely. After
more
that.
So. Yeah.
You know almost what? You have to.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you feel like that?
Yes.
Oh my God. I went 5 years before I joined a support group with essentially Club W, the Widows Club.
Yeah.
Right.
And I mean, we met over Zoom because it was still kind of like that's where we were.
Right.
But that made the biggest difference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That helped me get through and work through and process like so many things that I didn't even know I had to process. Like I couldn't put a name to it. I just was like, I don't know. I don't feel right. And to look at a screen full of women going, I know exactly what you're talking about. And I wasn't isolated. I had people in my life, but you feel so isolated.
Yeah.
Because you feel like you're the only one.
Because it happened to you.
It's a lonely place to be.
Yeah.
Other people lost their husbands, or their brothers, I should say, or sons or whatever. But you lost your spouse, like the person you're with.
And I was there when it happened, and that was like a whole another like...
Yeah. Layer of trauma.
Yeah. Several layers of trauma.
Yeah, that's like...
Several.
Yeah.
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 I mean, oof. Ugh. Yeah, I mean,
So on that note, I think we're halfway.
Yeah, I mean,
are we really halfway?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Oh,
yeah.
Empty beer bottles.
Like, yeah, beer bottles.
That's how
we.
Is that how we?
Yeah, that's how we. That's how we tell.
Oh my God, that's like the best.
Like sands through the hourglass. So are the beers of our lives. Anyway, whatever. It's better. I think we should. I think we should do Malort shots after this because it's.
You know what?
Okay.
Will you just punch me in the face?
The mic
I would prefer it if you just punched me dead in the face.
I'm pretty sure they don't have that here.
I got it. It's a classy joint. They might. All right.
We're gonna, Jesus, if they do this, it's gonna get ugly.
Stay tuned for the second half. Come back with a bloody nose and a
slur.
Here it comes, second half. Just after these messages from our sponsors.
Did you say sponsors?
I said sponsors.
That's cute.
Oh my god.
Save the world. It could be up to you. Wait a second. Wait a minute, and we're through.
Kinetic Legacy is the company that powers the Joe Contractor app. Their unique platform blends the good parts of social tech with their one-of-a-kind data organizing system, giving communities large and small a safe, private space to stay connected and to keep information and memories organized. If you and your community have a shared purpose or passion and are looking for a better way to stay connected, contact Kinetic Legacy today at kineticlegacy.us. Find out how groups from contractors to campers, tribal communities, unions, and alumni organizations are finding their way to meaningful new spaces in this increasingly digital world. Again, that's kineticlegacy.us.
If you're a fan of the show, you know that I love the outdoors. Several years ago, I stopped by a small, independent, and very much American-made little shop in Clarissa, Minnesota, called Battle Lake Outdoors. They sell the best quality canoeing packs, hunting packs, firefighting packs, and much more. Check them out at battlelakeoutdoors.com and use the coupon code LegacyMatters for a 5% discount on your order. Again, that's battlelakeoutdoors.com.
Wonder Woman Construction is a Minneapolis-based, woman-owned residential and commercial construction and electrical company. Lori and her team pride themselves on their commitment to long-term green and sustainable building practices, and they apply their deep understanding of building science to each project they take on. They are dedicated to the complete satisfaction of every client. One more thing that you absolutely cannot miss about Wonder Woman Construction is the fact that every employee loves what they do and truly enjoys working with each other. The best projects are those that are done by happy people. And Wonder Woman Construction is full of happy people. Visit WonderWomanConstruction.com to get started on your happiest project ever.
Save the world, it could be up to you. Wait a second, wait a minute, and we're through.
Okay. Second half, yeah. We made it back.
Usually.
We came right
it's
back.
It's tomorrow, but we're back.
Yeah, we're mostly
yeah, we
unscathed.
Took a nap.
No, I'm just kidding.
We needed it.
It's still the same day.
Good. Why would you do that?
Oh, did I?
You know what? You can do that after a Thanksgiving dinner in a couple days.
We didn't take a nap. We were gone for like 10 minutes.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's fine.
We refreshed our beverages.
Timers.
Yeah. Some of us.
Yep.
Our timers.
All of us.
Yeah,
okay,
right.
Close enough.
Don't call me without it.
Kim still had enough, yeah.
All right, close enough.
That's all right.
I mean, she's a guest, so she has to behave a little bit more.
Right, we're not here to... All right, get your face in there.
Yeah.
Make sure you're in there.
Guts to hear you. Yeah, you're in there now.
All right.
Pull it toward you if you need to. You can sit back. It's fine. It doesn't matter if there's a little...
Yeah, I need to, like, sit back.
There you go.
It's relaxed.
Yeah, you need to relax. It's the second half of the show.
Yeah, we're really kicking it in now.
Yeah.
If only I had a recliner.
Picking up...
I mean, the first half...
That'd be great down here.
That would be great.
A recliner.
Or hammocks.
You know, the worst part, the second half would just be me going...
Yeah, four people sleeping in chairs. It's a shitty podcast.
Yeah. Starts out good, but yeah, it's nice to go to sleep too. But
you know, as shitty as that podcast would be, there'd be people
into it. It's like snoring so relaxed.
Yeah, it'd be like a new popular
God, if you just started a whole new trend, I'm going
to
be upset.
Come on.
Yeah, but you better at least like market it.
I know. You know those weirdos. There'd be some weirdo out there.
There would totally be weirdos.
Oh, you listen to... You listen to four people snoring in chairs.
That's good.
Yeah. I like that one guy. He's really good at it.
Yeah, the guy with sleep apnea. Yeah, yeah, that's the guy.
It's fun. You never know. Yeah. Is he gonna make it? Is he gonna make it? I don't know if he's gonna make it.
Right.
And then it's three people sleeping in chairs. The sequel.
Oh my god.
Oh god, I went up to fix a cabin in Canada on an island with our maintenance guy at camp years and years ago. And the maintenance guy is old dude, yeah, you know? Yeah. Not super old, but anyway, old enough.
Yeah, careful.
Lonnie, rough dude. Love him to death. But Lonnie, we went up there and we were supposed to spend two or three nights and he snored so bad.
I can't do it.
Well, it's a small cabin and I really thought he was dead four or five times because of the sleep apnea.
Yep.
And I took my mattress and I
and I brought it to the other side of the cabin and I threw it on the floor and I'm like, God damn it. And then I'm like, oh, I can't sleep outside because the mosquitoes are so bad. But I just like, he's like, oh, how'd you sleep? Like,
I didn't.
Not yeah. one. Nope. Not yeah. one yeah. lick of sleep.
We're talking about, how about you, Ray Lonnie? Adam. Yeah,
he's you seem well sleeping. Rested.
Yeah, oh, that's awful. Yeah.
Oh, we could stay another day and fish. Yeah.
Like, no, we can't.
Nope. No, got to go back.
Well, I could sleep in the boat.
Do you want to stay an extra day? Yeah. No, I do not.
How has your wife not killed you? Is yeah. what I'm saying. I love that guy, though.
Yeah,
I love
right, him. Right.
He doesn't listen, I don't think. But if he does, yeah, I love you, Lonnie.
Right.
I love you.
I mean, my grandparents had separate bedrooms.
Oh, yeah.
Single
yeah.
beds in separate yep. bedrooms on opposite yep. sides of the house.
I feel like the longer you've been married, your bed gets bigger till finally they're separate.
Right.
Yeah.
We have a California king right now. I mean, it doesn't get any bigger.
Here we are.
I love you, but I want to sleep.
Yeah, exactly. Yep.
And you lost. Yeah. You lost See? Your Woody.
It's good.
Yeah.
Years ago. But yeah, had you been married, had he yeah. lived.
Yeah.
And it survived. He's right. The bed keeps getting bigger and bigger.
And it kind of, I mean, the reality is like he would always, if you were at a restaurant, if he was tired, he would just fall asleep.
Yeah.
So like it didn't even matter. Like it'd be like, and I'd kick him under the table. I'm like, dude. Like this and be like, why are you kicking me? I'm like,
I can get very, very relaxed.
Yes, you were.
Even when I'm watching TV. So every once in a while, I'll be like, are you sleeping? No, I'm just really relaxed.
And why did you make that snore noise? I didn't. I was clearing my throat. Yeah, yeah, I was clearing my throat.
No, but that's the new trend. Not the snoring.
Yeah,
no,
I was like,
that's no, I am such a trendsetter.
Yeah, me too.
Well, like in the new, yeah. like yeah. One of our clients, you know, they're developing all the new retirement homes, and they literally have his and her bedrooms with the joint bathroom.
Genius.
It is kind of smart. But, you know,
I don't think there's any shame in that. I mean, you can come over for a little cuddle visit every now and
again. Yes, and then go. Right. Well, I know I have somebody that I work with who talks about.
Who cuddle visits?
No, that's what he calls.
That's your cuddle visit?
Like, he calls it. He's like, yeah. He goes, well, then I just like have her go in the other room. I'm like, really? Like, you just start dating somebody and you're like, yeah, you can come in here and then you can go in the other room. I'm like, no, that's not how.
Oh, that's in dating land?
Yes.
Wow.
People apparently, when you get older, that's a dating land thing, too.
No, don't tell me that.
I better not. I mean, no, that's not working.
I wouldn't know. But.
I'm not having a cuddle land.
No, I mean, you have to be married. You have to, like,
yeah.
you
got
to
earn it.
You got to earn that shit.
You don't just get it.
Yes,
right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
You have to love and despise this person at the same time.
I love you enough to get the hell away from you.
Yeah.
It is. I always say.
It is.
I always say to people, the thing that you love about the person is actually the thing that will drive you crazy about them later.
Yeah, sure.
Right?
So there's a like lot
everything.
Of things.
Yeah, everything.
I got a lot of things going for me.
I love
me.
Everything about you. Oh, everything about you drives me crazy.
I love everything about you. If you could just maybe.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You're like, oh, no, no.
Yeah. Yep. Oh. I love.
That is so
love
funny.
Love marriage.
Mm-hmm. It's grand.
So sometimes when we interview people and. I don't feel like, you know, we've all done stuff. These guys are far more successful. Let's not say that. Is he pointing at us, Mark? Yeah, I'm pointing at the two of you. Let's say accomplished, right? But sometimes you have people in, like, and you're like, well, and then I did this, and I speak in front of these people and do that. Like, does it, do you feel cool because you're
I'm like, do you know it's really quiet on this side of the table? Like, where in the literal hell is he going?
Even our guest was like,
so
cool.
Do you think you're cool?
I'm like, I think I'm really cool because I've done.
Jesus, no, dude.
Thanks for asking because, yes.
Normally, see,
Thanks for noticing how cool.
I'll get in trouble because I'll like interrupt. Like, hey, let him. I was like, no, there's some times where I'm like, there's a reason I'm interrupting. I feel.
Did you feel like you had to take like.
I had. You can't say that way without building it up like that.
Well, you know what? Actually, it makes it more easy to answer the question.
Okay.
Yeah,
right?
Okay. Fair enough.
No, because here's the thing. Like,
I hated going out to DC.
Yeah.
You hated being doing something important. Yes. You didn't want the limelight.
Like, yeah, no, well, you didn't ask for it. You're like, this is what I want to do. It's like, you know what? This is what I have to do.
But I would always, so here, the ironic thing is Woody loved to go out to DC. He loved, like, his parents lived out there. He loved politics. I'm like, are you kidding? I hate politics.
Yeah.
Like, I hate everything to do with it. I go, I love going, because I went to LA all the time for work.
Oh, you're fast paced.
Yeah. So I would always go to LA for work stuff. And Woody would be like,
the weather's way better.
It's way better. And it was just, but Woody would always say, Hollywood's, or he goes, DC's just Hollywood with ugly people. That's what he would call it.
Okay. Yeah, but they're not just
ugly. He might have been onto something there.
Yeah, I think
they're ugly and rude. I mean, let's not forget that.
Ugly, rude, stuffy, and boring.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, stuffy, boring, whatever.
Right, so it's not the same.
Well, it's not, but you know what? Here's the thing I have to say. If it wasn't for my brother-in-law, who was married to my sister, who was like kind of partnered with me on this.
Yeah.
I didn't even know who, like I wouldn't have even, he was a, he went to
so this
St.
is
John's
a, this is a brother-in-law, right. Like.
My sister's husband.
Okay.
I'm just trying to put the connection
not
there.
The
so
cop.
This is not this is not a blood relative of
right,
yours.
Exactly. Right,
exactly. This
right,
is
right,
Woody's right. counterpart on the.
No, it's her sister's
husband. My sister's husband.
Right, but your sister's, or Woody was your sister's sister's husband.
No.
Different?
So my sister. Husband, his name's Eric.
Yep.
Mm. Eric and I became like partners when we'd go out to DC.
Okay.
But
I kept telling you another story. That was his brother.
I'm trying to interrupt.
So
what I'm
family?
Saying is that what I'm saying is that right. both of these guys were brother-in-laws. To two sisters.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
So they were each other's you know, they're each other's they're the same at the same level. So were they friends?
Yeah, they loved each other.
That's right. So they became good friends. And so when he died, it affected this other brother-in-law.
Yep. Yes. And it was only like my sister and I. Oh, yeah. Now I get where you were going.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because your brother-in-law
sometimes we just let him go because we know it's going somewhere.
Yeah. Sorry.
Like,
oh, my God.
And
don't worry.
There
my
it
friends,
is.
But my friends do the same thing. They're like, what is she doing? Like,
yeah,
I go, I'll
stay
get
with
you
it.
There.
Stay with it.
Just stay with it. Follow the bouncing ball and you'll always come back.
It does come back to
something. It always comes back.
It's just sometimes what it comes back to is not necessarily what people expect.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, fuck. Some Why of us, did he do that?
Some of us can see it coming because we've seen it before. We're like, no, let's go a different direction.
And why did he have to go so far?
So
afield?
Far.
Like,
it's like, so again, what was your first name?
The scenic route, ladies
like,
and gentlemen.
Was that necessary? Yeah, exactly.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah,
anyway, so you're off in D.C. being
so,
cool.
Yes. Yeah, we're. Well, yeah,
because
totally.
You're just,
I don't know about
you're
that.
Because you're just that way.
Yeah, I'm just that way. I'm cool.
Right.
So I go with my brother-in-law, and he, thank God, you know, he loved poli-sci, and he was a major like that.
Right.
So he knew. He'd be like, one night we were sitting out at the bar and we're like, you know who we need to meet next? We need to meet Senator Grassley. And then, so I'm like,
that's Chuck Grassley, folks.
Yeah,
okay.
from
for those
Senator,
of you from not
Iowa.
From D.C. or L.A.
Yeah, from, Iowa. I don't even know what he, like, I knew nothing, right? Nothing.
Yeah, like, why do I have to meet him?
Yeah. And then at 5 a.m. in the morning, Eric goes, don't look now, because we were flying back to Minneapolis. He goes, don't look now, but I think that's Senator Grassley over there. And I'm like,
I don't know where to look.
I don't even know where. I'm like, I don't even know what he looks like.
It's one of the old guys kissing a baby.
Yep.
Right. But I didn't even know what he looks like. And so thank God I had my brother-in-law who actually would be like, and I'm like, well, I don't have a problem going up and talking
like
to anybody.
Cards.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
He knew.
You know what? He knew.
Yeah.
But you don't have any trouble talking to people.
Right. And then, you know, and all of a sudden he went up and, you know, we said, oh, Senator Grassley, it was 5 a.m. And he was already investigating the kids in antidepressants.
Oh, okay.
And then, we went up and I, you know, my brother-in-law goes, hey,
by
Senator Grassley, you know, and then he goes, wait, is this happening to adults? And then I said, you know, told him Woody's story.
Right.
And he goes, this is happening to adults too.
Sure shit is.
Yeah. And he goes, come in, you can come into our office next time you're here.
Yeah.
And it literally started that relationship that then it led to investigations.
Yeah. In the right place at the
right
time.
You know what that's called?
The universe wanted that.
Yeah. It's called showing up. Magic happens when you show up.
I love that.
I completely believe in that stuff.
Yeah.
So do I.
Absolutely.
You just 100%. Keep doing things.
Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. Just show whatever.
Like, if you
would have
gone
passion.
To his office, like, he wouldn't have been there.
No.
And it wasn't
and
like
given you,
you were
20,
destined right then and there.
Yeah, and you would have been.
That was your time.
22, you would have met with, like, a 22-year-old staffer.
Right.
And then
who knows?
No idea.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Oh, I'll get that message
no
to
power.
Senator Grassley. Post
haste. How come you're not writing it down?
Yeah,
I don't know. Because I'm curling my hair.
No, and we had another one like that happened, too. So it was.
we were supposed to, it was like Martin Luther King Day. We were going to meet with, when it was Governor Plenty, his healthcare person. But it was Martin Luther King Day, and they're like, yeah, you can have a meeting with the healthcare person. We had this idea to do something in Minnesota. And we're like, we go to the Capitol. It's completely locked.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's Martin Luther King Day, right? It's,
why would you, but, who would schedule a meeting that day?
Right, yeah. But we were working. I was in advertising. Right, and I'm like, we're working.
We have a,
I didn't even think about it. So we're like knocking, and then finally the security guy comes out, and he goes, I'm like, we have a meeting with the senator, I mean, with the governor. And he was like, all right.
Sure.
You know, sure. I don't know if he's here, but whatever.
Sure, come on in.
Come on in. You'll look harmless.
Yeah, exactly. Look harmless.
I don't know if it would happen nowadays.
Yeah. No, maybe not so much.
No, not at all.
Because security guards are on to you women. You're not harmless.
No, you're not. Oh, yeah. Start going back to the beginning of the Congress.
That's it.
So I like how you just
Full circle.
Yeah, full circle. I like that. But we were waiting there, and all of a sudden, the next person, my brother-in-law, said, you know who we need to meet? We really need to get the Attorney General, Mike Hatch, involved. And my literally, uncle. Is it really?
Yeah. Yep. My uncle, my uncle by marriage. Uncle.
Is it really?
And it's his daughter. It's his daughter who died.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. You know what's so crazy?
Yeah.
All of a sudden, out of nowhere, here comes, we're waiting, sitting at the bench across from Palenti's office, and Palenti and Hatch didn't usually, you know, didn't exactly get along, right? They didn't really get along.
He can not get along with a whole lot of people. Mm-hmm. He's a really great guy.
But no, but different perspectives.
Yeah.
Oh, and he's very respectful and he's
a
great guy.
Well, no, but here's what's funny. We were sitting there, and out of the blue, like, all of a sudden, Hatch walks. That wasn't his real office. I guess he was in another. That's his more like his state capitol office.
Yeah.
He stops. He walks by and he goes, "What are you doing here?" And we're like, "Oh, we're supposed to be meeting with the governor." And he looked at and he's like,
"That guy ain't shit."
Yeah, he's not showing up. He's not showing up, right? Yeah. That's what he says to us. He goes in, and then Eric's like, my brilliant brother-in-law. Yeah. He's like, "Oh, I got an idea." He comes back out. And he's like, "You guys are still waiting?" And we're like, yeah. Like, I'm sure, I don't know what happened to the security guy. He went to go take a nap.
Right. He was tired.
He was snoring.
Yep.
And so he comes back, and he comes back out, and he goes, "Well, what are you guys doing here?" And we're like, "Oh, actually, we have an idea. Would the state of Minnesota ever join this lawsuit against Pfizer?" And he goes, "I hate Pfizer."
Yeah.
And then he goes, because he took on the drug companies and big tobacco.
He was, he did an amazing job.
So he comes back and he goes, you need to talk to this guy, Mike Vanzolo, on Monday, whoever. Mm-hmm. Literally out of nowhere, that guy that he said we had to talk to his, you know, at the office, he and his son, because his 8-year-old son was had to stop and pick up something he left at the office.
They materialized out of thin air.
Yeah. Literally. And all of a sudden, we went to go meet with the governor, and here we're sitting with Mike Hatch and the guy, and all of a sudden we call our lawyers. We're like, "I think we got the state of Minnesota to join
just
the
FYI.
Lawsuit." We're like,
on an off day.
No, really? Why are you calling?
You know, it's Martin Luther King. We're not in the office. I mean, why are you calling me at home?
I'm charging you double for this.
Oh my
what
God.
Now?
Yeah. What? And they were like, literally, that kind of stuff happens when you're doing like the right thing in life.
Yep.
And you're on the right path, or like, and also that you show up.
Yeah.
You can't, you
you're
know.
Right.
Yeah.
It's about just showing up. It'll never happen.
Our, like, graduation from high school, wasn't it like, wake me when it's over, or whatever
that was our slogan. Yeah, wake me when it's over, class of 93.
Wow.
We graduated high school together.
So embarrassing.
I'm like,
wake me when it's over.
Yeah.
I mean, don't let the Arctic Blonde, I've been told it's Arctic Blonde.
Arctic Blonde. Is that what I can't wait for that.
I'm going to use it.
That's so not right.
My God.
I was getting my hair cut in Canada, and I looked at my beard, and I was like, "Ooh, there's getting to be a lot of gray in my beard." And the gal goes, "Oh, honey, that's not gray. That's Arctic Blonde."
Oh, my God.
And I'm like, oh,
I love
she was looking for
so
a good tip.
Much.
Guessing she got
Shout
one.
Out Canada.
Good tip or a good time? I'm not sure.
Yes.
But anyway, no, the only reason I brought up the wake me when it's over thing is because there is something about the Gen Xers of the world, which is sort of like, don't get involved. You know, we're disaffected or whatever. We don't. I don't even necessarily get too involved in things.
But you're right. Like, someone's got to go out there and do this work and advocate for people.
But it's not only that. Like, when you just said how when you guys came together as this, showing up is meaning showing up here. Like, doing these things.
These two are solid as
community. Yeah, like, you know
we
what I mean?
We show up and do this every week. Yeah. No one pays us.
No.
Yeah, because it's fun. Like, Well, because I'm like, I don't know.
You don't get paid for fun? Right.
Damn it.
Yeah, exactly. I wish you did.
Because there's always an interesting conversation.
Yeah, we like doing it.
But
you
show up
this.
In life. Like, but I think showing up is not necessarily even, like, advocacy. It can be any, like, I just had this happen to be my thing. But doing, if you want anything in life, it doesn't happen when you're just sitting around or even
it's
how you
It's not coming
said,
to you. No. You have coming, to go get it.
And then it comes together because doors open. And right.
Couldn't
you know,
agree more.
Yeah. Yeah. So
you know,
anyways.
It's showing up.
Magic
happens. Something gets weird and tingly inside when we talk about like how to make people's lives better.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Because,
yeah.
Well, because I don't know what people are going to do for themselves. But yes, just doing whatever it is
that makes
something.
You happy, yeah. Like, yeah. But it, I mean, but I'm telling you, like, when you just said it, you had all like tingly when it's because I'm like, because you know why you're speaking truth,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You know how you said you this formula doesn't work on Zoom, it's because you have to show up,
yeah.
Your energy comes to it's energy, yeah.
But we have a disclaimer on the show that says that you can't take anything we've said as if it were. Fact or truth. Yeah.
No, we just say we don't check facts. That doesn't mean any of it's not factual. It might be. We just don't know.
I love that. Yeah. Like, that's such a good... No, it's because you're having a conversation.
Yeah.
Like, you're showing up.
It's a good, open conversation. Where you actually get to know people and hear their true stories and figure out what, like, I think, and that's why the show is Legacy Matters, I think everyone has an important and awesome story of some, and it's not, we get people who, so it's always tough for me when people say you should have this person on the show because they tell stories well or whatever. Like a storyteller isn't what we're looking for. I don't give a shit about the stories you tell.
Cause you're going to tell a story you've told 100 times. I don't care about that.
Yeah. That's what we're here for, is to get to know people.
But I was, I don't know if when you're up in the bathroom or not, but I'm like, this reminds me of my brother-in-law's in Chicago, Woody's brother, where they all, like, the neighbors all come together
party
to hang out.
Party in the garage.
Party in the garage. And it's just, like,
hanging out around a campfire.
And everybody's just shooting the shit. Yeah. And, like, sometimes you cry. Sometimes you laugh. I mean, most of the time you laugh.
Yeah.
But you're, like, living real life. And I love, this is what we need in the world. We need this.
Does it, conversations. I mean, it makes me feel like we're doing something right.
You are doing something right.
See, I'm deeply Minnesotan, and I really can't take compliments.
Oh, you said you can't take compliments?
Can't, no. It's just weird.
I don't think it... I mean, maybe it's Kate's...
No.
I know.
See,
I know.
I was enjoying your awkwardness. Yes. That's why I smiled.
Your craziness. Yeah. We're Minnesotans. You can't say nice things about us like that.
No, right. I totally agree, because you're like... Yeah. You don't want to tell people... I mean, I have the same problem.
Do you? Yeah.
Yeah, literally.
I mean, it really is kind of an upper Midwestern
thing.
Oh, yeah.
Thing.
I mean, it's kind of... But then at the same time, you're like watching all these Yahoos on Instagram flashing stuff. And
doing
like,
stupid shit.
I'm like, really?
It doesn't matter.
They don't care. Why do I care that I'm like...
It's because they grew up on the coasts.
We're like, I don't want to tell you I've been
too much
like,
sun. That's what that is.
Yeah. Or too much gray or whatever goes on in New York. But people, you know, it's true. Generally speaking, there's something baked into different parts of the community or whatever. And people, like, you'll meet these people with all the bravado in the world. They don't really do anything.
Yeah. You're like, why are you?
But then all the Minnesotans are super quiet. Like, I'm even having a hard time saying that we're doing anything. Like,
yeah, exactly. This is something, right? I don't know.
Yeah,
we pushed a button and talked. I don't think that counts.
Right,
does
and they're making fun of it. But yet, in the reality is, literally, this is what matters. Is like... because everybody has, like, I do believe everybody comes into this world to be self-expressive or creative. Everyone's creative.
Oh, yeah. I think everyone's
because they have
got
a story.
To be beautiful.
Yeah. Like, you
everyone's
can
creative
be.
And can slowly and, be beaten out of you through school and work.
Yeah, and then you become an adult.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing. We all come into this world
to like who your natural being, yours, mine, you know. But we like something like our light goes down, and then you're from Minnesota and it goes even really down.
Yeah, that's true.
And then it goes like
we hibernate a little in the winter.
And so now it's really dark.
And, like, God,
and
what time is it?
You totally get us. You totally get us.
Well, I'm from Minnesota, so I totally get it. Yes. I'm like, I do the same thing.
Yeah. Like, you know. Stop looking at me, everybody. I'm not, I don't need your praise.
Yeah. I don't need to hear it. I don't.
Some quiet Norwegian. Scorn or something.
Something I'm accustomed to.
Right.
Scorn porn. Yeah. Do they have that?
I don't know, but I like where you're headed with that. YouTube channel of Midwesterners taking compliments poorly and denying that the compliment should exist. Right. And I mean, that is scorn porn.
That is a funny. Like, that
someone
is funny.
Someone standing in the corner just looking at you like, you fucked it all.
Shaking the head.
How could you?
No, sir. No.
Oh, you make me feel right at home.
Yep.
Yeah.
God.
Oh my God. But I remember. Well, this will tell you. So I remember coming back from DC, and I literally like this was a kind of something that I was maybe a little proud of. Like I got invited to testify at the U.S. Senate. I mean, this was a big deal.
So you sat on the floor of the Senate.
Yeah, it was a pretty big deal.
That's a huge deal.
I mean, she's like, I was maybe a little bit. I mean, but how many of our other friends have testified in front of?
Zero.
I'm counting you. As a friend now.
Yeah.
One.
I love it.
That I can admit.
One.
I know one. But anyway, you can admit. No, you can't talk about it.
Right. Sorry.
Anyway, so you.
No,
so
but like I come home and I was like, oh, you know, my dad's got to say something. I'm sure because he loves to pick me up. Right. You know, like I'm still his little kid.
Right.
And so he picks me up and I was like, oh, he might say something like, oh, whatever.
I'm proud of you, daughter.
Yeah.
I love you.
Hey, good job.
Good luck.
He says, well, so how was the weather? I'm like,
holy Midwesterner.
I'm like, born are you raised, kidding me?
Born and raised.
And I remember I told my mom, I'm like, Mom, and she goes, well, no, he tells everybody else. I'm like, could he say anything?
No.
Like,
nope.
No.
You have lipstick on your teeth. What?
Yeah, no. That ain't how we're raised. That's not what happens.
So. You got to meet.
What'd you have for lunch?
Yeah. You got to meet.
So how was your flight?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Great. Anything else? No.
No, exactly.
Mom's at home.
Oh, Congress. Yeah, whatever. you got to meet Heather Asbury. Raspberry. She said, like raspberry.
Yeah, but without the
The R.
Yep. Mm.
Oh, who's that?
It just sounds like I'm saying Asbury, though.
Asbury.
Asbury, thank you.
Raspberry? You know, just lean into the Z a little bit.
Yeah.
You get away from the ass.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
Heather, Asbury. Damn it.
I got him.
It's almost like you in names.
Oh, I can't do it. Heather Asbury, she owns a restaurant in town. Heather's, and she told us the story.
Oh, I know her. We talked about her.
Yeah, she was on the show. They forget.
We
so
were
what
both
was it?
No
retention and no, what was the other one? Research, yeah.
Oh, you couldn't remember that?
I couldn't remember that. 2 hours.
It was minutes ago that you said it. Go ahead.
It was a lifetime ago.
It was a break ago.
Anyway, she told the story of she started her, I believe it was her first restaurant.
Yeah.
But anyway, when she opened up Heather's, her dad would stand outside Heather's and like heckle her by telling the other people waiting in line, like, is this taking forever? Feels like it's taking longer.
Right.
Her dad.
Stop.
Yeah.
She like had to ask him, you got to go home. Like, leave me alone and let me.
He was trying to just to make it better or something? Or
I
like,
have no idea. She has no idea. Yeah, and by all accounts, he's like, you know, the man loves her.
Of course.
He's there to support her.
Is the food taking a long time?
It feels weird. But his way of supporting is to stand there and be like, God damn it, you guys are slow.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yep.
Oh my God. It is funny. Like, I don't know what
thanks,
that is.
Dad.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The weather was great.
Yeah, the weather was great.
Yeah, it was nice.
I've been inside all day, but the weather was great.
Yeah. It was
when
great.
When was the last
thanks.
Time you sat in front of Congress, Dad?
Mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm sure he's going to say,
well, have
he's
you met
proud
your mother?
Now.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Have you met your mother?
It's an inquisition every damn day in our house. Oh my goodness, what have we done?
This is a show again.
A show. Yeah. I love it. I hope you know what? I hope you're on your next time you have a guest, you're like, that Kim, who was she?
That's what he'll be like. Yeah.
He'll be like, Kim, what was she? What one
I
was
got
she?
Nothing.
Like, oh my God. Oh my God, I'll be so sad.
Because I care about the moment.
So, you know what?
That's what else
you
do.
You are in the moment.
I'm in the moment. Yeah. I care about this.
Yeah.
And then the
that
next
present. That's yes, why they gotta be present. The present is a
present
gift.
What's going
it
on.
Is a gift.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. I like it. So what else do you do?
What do you do for fun?
What else do I like to do?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. What do I love to do? You know what I've loved to do, started to do? Dancing.
Okay.
You know what?
My mother is a huge dancer.
Maybe really? Not Minnesota.
Got into,
like partner dancing?
Lessons,
like Arthur Miller Studios?
Not Arthur Miller.
Like,
He's gone.
Salsa? No. Well, it
Square
was kind of,
but he still has studios like,
it was
that
kind
are named
of,
Arthur Miller?
No, I just like I start going to my friends go to EDM concerts. Like,
yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And I love, like, I never did that in all my
like
college.
The kind where you put the
glow sticks
like, the
and
silent
pacifiers.
Ones.
Yeah, okay.
Everybody
glitter.
Has headphones and it's right. like
glitter on right. my face.
Super quiet.
Okay.
Like,
but
okay.
not
you
quiet.
Guys, whoa.
Above and
beyond. Wait a minute. Yeah. Hold on a second.
I understand. Yeah.
I got to do this. You go to what?
Yeah, EDM.
You guys all jumped in like you know, like everyone knows what that
oh,
is.
Oh, sorry, we forgot it, Sam.
Let's
electronic dance music.
Dance music.
Yeah.
But
EDM.
Okay, but I just have to, like, I got to paint
Fox.
A picture.
The next phase of techno,
you got to paint a picture for the other people.
for the six other people who don't know what that
exactly.
is. So,
yeah.
so now that we
brought them all up to speed.
Oh, God. I realize everyone else
here,
is cooler than me.
No, put it in perspective, Sam.
Know,
ready?
Like,
so what is EDM is electronic dance music.
Yeah, but it's like the chill music. Like, yeah, he was just playing it.
Yeah.
What were you doing? And it's constantly going.
Oh, but then he'll go to the bass drop.
The bass,
oh, yeah.
And then you're like,
Yep, bring it up, and you drop it.
I feel like I was in the 90s
you've
once.
Heard it.
You know what? You probably did, because all my friends said,
I feel like I've heard
we
this.
Used to do that when we were younger, and I'm like, yeah, but I didn't. So now,
so I'm doing it now.
Yes. And you know what? I believe that is, like, it doesn't matter how old you are. Like, I'm not going to just subscribe
to. Do you
have
to take ecstasy?
No. Like, you can just, like, feel it in
your
body.
Show up.
Like,
boy, I don't know.
It works sober.
When you brush
it works. It does work sober.
Mm-hmm.
You just feel it. You have to get out of your head.
Well, yeah. Think when you go see live music.
And into your body.
Sometimes you'll see someone, like a live musician that maybe you weren't into. You're like, I don't know much about him. And all of a sudden you're like, hey,
I like this.
No,
This is working for me.
I am a huge fan, actually, of music.
Yeah.
I couldn't tell you.
He has a calendar.
Have you heard of this band? New Kids on the Block? They're fucking awesome. No,
Jonas Brothers?
Yeah. No, I'm a huge fan of music. I listen to it all the time. I can't tell you what instruments are making what sound. It's all weird to me that even happens.
I'm like that.
And then you see three people and they're up there and you're like, wow. And if I follow the guy drumming, I can be like, oh my God, I can pick out the drum beat.
Yeah.
But I have to watch it in order for it to happen. Otherwise, it's all just one wave of thing coming.
I'm kind of the same. I'm the same way. Like, I love music. I don't know what I'm listening, but all of a sudden you kind of feel it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the tribal, like.
I struggle with the feeling of it part, but I know that I haven't at various points in my life. But I have
I'm
to get
sad for you.
Yeah. No,
I bet he does.
But I still really enjoy it.
When he watches the drum, you're like feeling it.
I still love it. But if I went to the place, I would be like, everyone just leave me alone. I'm sitting here watching you all do this thing that I can't do, but I'm loving every minute of it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but me being the guy out on the floor, like flailing around and catching the rhythm, it's going to be a while. I'm telling you.
You know what?
We're okay.
There's a lot of work. A lot of work.
We're okay with that.
I see.
I've seen you dance. We're all right.
Like there's like a really awkward daddy-daughter dance in your future, and I can't wait for you.
She's the only person I'll dance with.
See?
Andy,
I have a 7-year-old, and I will. If she wants to dance, I'll dance.
Yeah, see?
Your wife asks, and you're like, I don't want to step on your feet.
No, my wife doesn't ask. She looks at me. She's like, please
stop
dancing. Please stop. Oh, Jesus. There he goes again.
I never
liked
to do
it. Who gave him tequila?
I never liked to do it. And then all of a sudden, like one day, I was like, wait, all those years. That like Woody would always like let's go dance. He could care less. He'd be sober. He'd be the first one on the dance floor, and I'd be like, oh, I have to have a lot to drink before I go out there.
Yeah.
And then now I'm like, wait, why didn't I do this?
Yeah.
But I think you start learning different things when you get older, and then all of a sudden you're like,
wait, I don't know how much long, like, I don't know how long
you
I have.
You get that attitude and just like, fuck it,
I'll try
it.
The way these knees are, you know, who knows how long I'll be able to do.
Totally.
Yeah.
Well, I realize.
If you have like a little girl, you should, I mean, of course you're going to do anything. Right. Just make sure you ask her more than how the weather is when she gets older.
Oh,
no.
No, no problems.
I think that generation
there.
Is past.
You think it's gone?
Right. Oh, yeah. I mean,
I think it's gone.
We've seen what it's like.
Oh, yeah. We've seen what it's like. It's like, yeah, I'm not doing that.
No.
Right. You're not. You're like,
I'm probably more
change.
Involved than I should be, but it's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm certainly trying my best. So Andolyn is her name, and she's really cute.
Oh, cute. Mm-hmm.
She's very pretty.
Yeah. Right? How old? Seven?
Seven. And I sort of hate it when that. Everyone addresses her as beautiful or pretty or, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. So I want to make sure that she knows that I think she's smart and strong.
Yeah.
How do you do that at the same time? I do think she's adorable too. Right. Like I can't, you know, like I want her to
feel pretty.
I'm sure
that comes through there. Yeah.
I just don't, girls, like, I don't want that to be the only thing she thinks that is of value in her is the prettiness.
Especially
part.
Coming from her dad.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
that's you're not just a little toy.
No.
And so, you know, I try and be a little hard on her sometimes.
Yeah, you have
let her
to
know.
Be.
Yes.
That's all right.
You have to be. I am.
Do you have, daughters?
I have two girls, 13 and 16.
And they are really good kids.
And it's just the only problem with trying to raise
I know what this problem is.
Free thinking, very strong women as you end up with them when they're 13 and 16 and think they're already there.
Sassy little.
There's some sass.
Oh. Yeah. But then aren't you like at the same time, like, don't you love knowing I have all nieces in my life.
Oh my God. They are just.
I wish,
but you have to be able to look at them.
There's some times where, you just want to look and go, I fight the urge every once in a while, because I said so. Jesus, can we just do this?
Right.
But I explain it because I'm like, okay, I owe it to you to explain why I'm saying this.
But
what's
you have to be two-faced as a father at that point, because on the face that's pointing toward them has to express anger at their actions.
But
why
are you laugh, right?
But the other one's God, you're so strong that you're standing up to me.
Because you'd be like, God, that was a great burn.
Wow. I don't want to acknowledge how happy I am.
Good job.
Write that down.
And you're
that
in trouble.
A sick burn.
Yeah.
Totally.
God, you got me on that one.
Well, I have, I collect kids.
Yeah.
So,
that's weird.
You know what it is?
You know, you admitted that out loud. I don't know if that's a good or bad thing.
Yeah, I mean, this is I can't edit.
I didn't see what you pulled up in. I didn't see a van. I don't know what you got going on.
Are the police looking for you?
Oh, my God.
We may need to.
I collect kids.
Yeah, I think
we got our first viral moment.
Yes,
we caught a serial kidnapper. Yes.
I feel like you're going somewhere else.
This.
Yes,
she does.
Do you
this,
always drive a dock truck?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. We lulled her into.
Like, come on, kids.
This is a totally safe space. You can tell us that you collect
children. Yes, it'll go nowhere.
Like I collect all my friends. Well, I have a bunch of nieces. And one nephew.
Yeah.
But even I had a long-term relationship after Woody and I, and we broke up. But I still the nieces. I'm their aunt.
Yeah.
You know what? Yep. I also believe. So this is going to go down another path.
Yeah.
But just because a relationship ends, whether death, divorce, you don't have to
It doesn't actually end.
It doesn't have to end.
Yeah.
You can still have the kids that, you know, because they didn't have anything to do with it. And if you're the aunt, you're the aunt.
There's still that relationship.
Plus, relationships don't end.
They don't end.
They change.
Yep.
They change.
And they can change dramatically. Yes. And you
well said, sir.
You know?
Yeah, that's super, deep.
Oh, shit.
I don't know about super. Uh-oh.
Again,
don't worry. Wait for it.
Let's call it what it is. It was mildly
pathetic.
Wait
till it comes around. We'll see where it goes.
No, no, but it's true. I it drives me nuts when I see people who've... divorce, especially if they have kids. If you don't have kids and you both go your own way and you hate that person that you used to love, fine, whatever. But you don't actually probably hate them. You hate the end of the relationship something, you know?
Yep.
And relationships, they just change over time. Yeah. And sometimes you're not meant, you're better off being in separate locations.
Yep. Yes.
Right? Yep. But the kids have no say in it all and you do not... ever.
Totally.
You don't have to abandon the children.
Absolutely. No. Like, and I feel like I've seen that where they do.
Yeah,
but like terrible. For me, I was like, well, first of all, you know, my ex, he probably didn't like the fact that I, collected the
right.
kids.
You're
but
good
I didn't
it.
Really, because I was just a cool aunt.
Yeah, exactly.
I know, I probably need to have to
I see that getting you into trouble.
Yeah, you're right. Like, yeah. that's probably not the right thing.
We totally
the,
get what you're saying.
No, but like, you don't have to, and probably partly because after Wood died, like, of course, they're all my family.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I'm not going to all of a sudden
go. Just stop being your family.
Yeah.
It probably just changes your perspective.
Well, that was yesterday. Now, today we're moving on.
Yep. You don't belong anymore.
No.
So.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure death that close to you just changes your perspective, too.
It does.
Yeah. You know what? I think it does. I mean,
of course it does.
It does. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Quite a bit.
Just a guess.
I wasn't trying to be profound. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
I was like,
no, but the funny thing is, it not only changes your perspective, it changes other people's perspective of you,
right?
Then allowing you the opportunity to, you know, get into those types of situations because you're the person who lost someone.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Like, because families are complicit in cutting out the exes too.
Yeah.
Where,
yeah,
you know, they'll be like, oh,
sometimes,
mm-hmm. you know,
yeah,
a lot of times.
And that's shitty. Like,
I mean, sometimes you're probably like, oh, I don't really like them anyways.
No, I'm
but,
okay with it.
Yeah.
But sometimes you're like, hey.
Yeah.
You ask most 6 or 7 or 10 year olds, like what relation their uncle or aunt is to them. And they're like, I don't know. My dad calls every friend he's got an aunt or uncle. Or whatever.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like they don't really know.
Mm-mm.
So like so-and-so got divorced. The kid's like, so what?
Yeah.
What
they don't know.
So now I don't get to be with that person ever again.
Yeah.
It's just stupid.
Like it doesn't. And they also like, I don't think that kids actually even know what it is. I feel like they know the feeling that they have around that person.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, oh, I love like dad's friend. Like he's super cool. Like, and it doesn't matter if, you know.
I called every one of my friends Uncle So-and-so, like Uncle Marty or Uncle Glenn or whatever.
Okay.
To all of my kids, even though they're not related. They're not uncles.
Right.
But, I mean, they don't need to know more than that. Like
that's
this is,
enough.
Actually, and in doing that moniker to me is like, this is an adult male that you should trust.
Yeah.
Like if I'm calling this person Uncle So-and-so, it means that you trust them. And then when they got older, they're like, Marty's not really our uncle, is he?
Like, it's like,
no, have to be married to someone in the family.
Exactly. Like,
it's fine.
Oh, I get it. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my God. That's so fun.
Well, anyway, we fixed everything.
Yeah. It's good.
Yeah.
Again.
Everything's solved.
I mean,
I can't believe we did
it. So, what are we going to do moving forward? We're not going to solve this right now. This is the longest one we've recorded in a long time.
Yeah,
it's
great.
It's because the conversation is so natural.
It's good.
Yeah.
But what are we going to do to fix the world? What's our next steps?
You know what? I'm going to say having conversations like this with real people.
You're
going
to send people our way? You're
going to conversations.
I can't tell them.
You're going to tell all your friends to listen to the show?
Absolutely. Yeah. You know
awesome.
What I'm
going
to tell?
Keep having conversations about everything.
I love. Why not? Because even if I have no idea what you guys, you know how we've, the last couple of years, especially in the world, it's so awful. Like you can't, and you're like, how many times even with what I've, like my work I do, and they're like, you're an anti-vaxxer. I'm like, I am.
When did that happen?
Oh,
how did you arrive at that conclusion?
All the labeling
so wrongly.
And shaming and division.
Oh, it's ridiculous.
It's craziness.
It's easier to do that than actually try and get to know someone.
Exactly. Right. And that's why I love what you guys are doing. Yeah. Honestly, like I think back to when I first went out, I was called by one of the big national mental health organizations. Mm. They went around and told everybody I was a Scientologist because I was speaking out.
Oh, because that would other you and shame you and
make you
a lunatic.
Yeah, like a lunatic.
Because at that time, that was the bad thing.
That was the thing. Right. And so now it is like the anti-vaxxer, or they'll be like, oh, you're a Trumper. I'm like, I voted for him. Like, you guys,
when
it was like
happen?
Labeling all this stuff. And I was like,
stop distracting from the real problem.
Yeah. And so this is why I'm going to tell people about, this has literally been my most favorite podcast because we're just having
you've done these before.
Not, I mean, not this conversation.
No.
But I've mean, yeah, been on.
You said you worked in radio. You did like your own show or something at one point.
No, I just have been on different, different ones. Okay. But most of them have been Zoom.
Right.
And you don't get this.
No.
Oh, no,
but
it's not the same.
No, but I have to just say, I love just having sitting around and having conversations because I think this is really when that will fix the world.
Yeah.
Honestly, one conversation at a time.
Talking to people, about stuff.
And stuff.
Yeah.
It feels like a really big task, but I completely agree.
Yeah.
It's why we keep doing this.
But do you think it is a big task? You guys, like, I just came in here and it's super easy sitting down.
Oh, no, I'll tell you what, if I got paid to do this, I'd do this all day, every day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, no, actually, it takes a lot of energy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I do it once a day.
But you have to want to do it.
And I might want to take a little break from that every now and again.
You might need a break.
But I mean, this is one of the most enjoyable things that I do in my week.
Yeah.
So, it's so
having
cool.
conversations and getting to know people.
Yeah. And I think I've said this before, conversation is maybe like, let's not let it be a lost art.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just start talking.
We're going to come back to it anyway. I mean,
sure.
Humans, I
still call people and leave voicemails, and they're like, what are you doing? No one does it anymore.
I know. That's the problem. I love that.
I do it just to piss you off.
Yeah, me too.
My wife is like, you left me a voicemail again. I go, yeah,
I do it all the time.
I do it because you don't like it. Yep. It makes me happy.
And this is sort of an extension.
Because then I got to listen to it. I go,
Yep.
Yeah. I talk to people like this when we go places.
Yeah.
And my kids are like, oh, God, damn.
Oh, God. Here we go.
Dad's going to just talk to this waitress at the bar.
Stranger danger.
Oh, look at him. He's acting like he knows her. Oh, he's talking. Like, you know. But, no, I think when I say it seems like a big task, what I mean is that bringing – I guess what I would say is Americans. We'll just focus on America right now. Bringing Americans back to a place where they can understand that their cousin in the country who did vote for Trump and the one in the city who did vote for Biden, that they're not bad fucking people and that you don't have to hate both of those people.
No, you don't have to hate. One of them made a bad choice. Right. One of them made the right choice. It's fine. Everyone does that.
Yeah. Right? We're not saying
it's
who.
It's fine. I'm not saying it's up to you to decide.
I mean, just figure out that we're all in the same thing together.
Yeah, like
we're not
life.
That far off.
Talking.
Yeah.
Like,
it's weird. When you talk to people, you realize you have things in common.
Like most everything.
So weird.
Yeah. Exactly. Like, but so imagine if you just, when you're like, oh no, I know who you are. I know who you are.
Yeah, I already got you labeled.
I know who you are. I already got you labeled.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, how many times I would even be out, like, and I know I'll keep talking, so I'm making your show go longer.
That's all right.
We're just talking.
I would be out wearing it like at all these conferences, and everybody has like MPH, like all I call it the letter alphabet soup, behind their names, and you can see they're like looking at my name tag, and they don't see anything, so they automatically ignore me.
Yeah, they
move
on. Like
they
move
on. Like oh shoot, I can't.
You're not
she'll
important
have
enough,
right?
If you can read this, you are staring too much.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, so it's weird. And so one time I was at a conference where it asked me for my college education, so I just said BA. Mm. So it said Kim Witczak BA. And, like, you would never put that on because it's all the other stuff.
It's not important enough.
It's not important.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so all of a sudden I was like, oh, my God, but it's a speaker. I have to wear it. And I was super embarrassed. And then somebody there goes, no, you know what that BA means? Badass.
Yeah.
And so then I was like, oh, I love that. But it was one of those things that I saw people labeling, like, oh, you voted for Trump? Oh, I already know who you are. I don't need to know you.
And they're sizing you up by the credentials after your name, though?
Yeah, exactly.
Without a single word.
Without nothing talking.
I just did an air finger.
I mean, that's not showing up, frankly.
No.
You know what I mean? Like,
that's not showing up.
But
you're just taking the easy way out and not having the conversation.
Yes.
You're taking the easy way out because you're just...
Yeah, easy. I already know who
scared.
You are.
Can your acronym be stop staring at my boobs?
Yeah. They might actually come and talk to me then.
Yeah, they'd be like, okay, they might be interesting. Yeah.
Kim, Witczak? Was that what it was?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm super impressed.
Yeah.
That never happened.
And then dot and then little letters, stop staring at my boobs.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah. That's what it should say.
Mm-hmm.
I wait until I do.
Mm-hmm. They're here first.
I collect kids.
I collect kids and don't stare at my boobs.
My credentials are whatever. I don't even know where to go from there. Oh, man. Well, I'll tell you what. let's do this. Let's plan a second date.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
We'll have you in. You can come give us an update in like a year or something.
Yeah.
6 months, great. whatever you want.
Absolutely. But just,
oh my God, I love it.
Somewhere down the road, because I guarantee you that show will be even weirder.
Yeah.
I can't
because
wait.
Because we already got through all the shit. Info. So then we'll just talk about whatever.
Yeah, yeah. I love it.
So I found out what Joey's doing.
Yeah. And I'll give you an update on. Yeah.
I reached out to Buttafuoco.
Yep.
And I'll find out what John Wayne Babbitt's doing.
Yeah.
Exactly. At.
Yeah.
There needs to be some follow up.
Yeah, we didn't even talk about like all the funny things when I worked at Jenny Jones' talk show.
Jenny Jones. I kind of remember that there was a person named Jenny Jones.
Yeah, she was like. With her and Jerry Springer.
Yep.
Yeah.
It was that
Ricky
era.
Ricky Lake
so wait, you
era.
Had some stories from
talk
her?
Show era.
Yeah.
But that's like confrontational talk shows, right? Where they're like, kind of, okay, well, everyone.
Real quick.
Yeah.
Were you still with Jenny Jones in the infamous like
the
outing?
Murder.
Yeah.
The murder. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
what?
Here,
what?
I mean, it's so crazy.
They had a show where they like basically outed a guy. And like surprise bombed him on stage, and then
that
night it did not go well.
Somebody got murdered. But
yeah,
so here's the thing. Oh. I will just a piece of
Jeez
advice,
Louise. You know what? I hope that doesn't happen here on our show.
Yeah, exactly.
No, I just want to throw it out there. I got to knock on wood.
I think we said multiple times. I don't know anything.
Yeah.
Please.
Piece of
any
advice.
Future
if anybody,
guests, don't murder people.
No. Yeah. If anybody ever says like, I want you on. Well, that I got to think about that.
Yeah.
But every time when they say any of the talk shows, I'm like, I'm sorry if somebody is going to call and say, hey, we want to have you come on the show. We've got a secret that somebody wants to, unveil to you.
I would go with
I'd
no.
be like, ooh, maybe not. But a lot of those people wanted to come because they got a free refrigerator full of food and drink at the hotel.
Right. Right.
And so then you're
the
holy, right. And you got a trip to Chicago.
Right.
I mean,
but
free stuff,
it seems
a little bit of fame.
Predatory. Like the people on those shows are definitely not in the best
mental state
usually
question mark.
But so someone the secret was like so and so sleeping with your ex or something
like
that,
your
and
best friend like a guy told his best friend that he had a crush on him.
Oh, he was gay, and then he killed him.
So
that sucks.
Yeah, so it was like not a very exciting thing, but
no,
it was. I will say this: and I'll like be quiet. But every 5 minutes, because it was a syndicated talk show, so every 5 minutes on the hour, it'd be like, "Is your life stranger than fiction? Do you have a story that must be told? Call 1-800-JENNY." So the phones would just ring.
Oh my God.
And you'd be like, everybody would be like,
remember
no matter
part.
What, you know, what position you had in the company, everybody took their phone calls and be like, oh, okay, that sounds great. Okay. Give me your number. Okay.
Right.
And so like, literally,
so you just, like,
that's how you got the stories.
Crazy people's,
Collins.
Not crazy people. I'm sorry. That's labeling.
Just people who have different lives than
right.
live
different
else.
Lifestyle choices.
Eesh. That sounds
rough. So yeah, we'll have a lot to talk about. Yeah.
All right.
All right, cool.
All right,
so stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
Well, now that you've listened to 3 hours of our first show.
Exactly.
We're at 50
There's
minutes
more
in our
to come.
Half,
sweet.
There's a lot to come.
This was
good.
Great.
This was awesome.
Oh, I'm like, is that a
Thank
lot?
Thank you.
No, Kim, it was really, really nice meeting you.
Great.
Yeah.
Thanks so much
Super
for coming
fun.
On.
Yes.
Thank you for coming on, and thank you for sharing your story.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing your trauma.
Yeah.
Yep.
I can appreciate that quite a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. This has been fun.
See ya.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Likewise.
Cool.
Loved it. All right.
Loved it.
Thank you.
Thanks, you guys.
Peace.
Bye.
Well, you did it. You made it to the end of another show. Thank you all so much for listening to our show. We really, really appreciate it. Don't forget to send us your questions, comments, or even your guest requests. Maybe you want to be a guest. Maybe you know someone who would be a great guest. Send them in to info@legacymatterspodcast.com. All right. See you next time. Thank you. The theme music and all the other music that you've heard on this show is created by and recorded by the fabulous Captain Al. Check him out.